significantly changed what I'm doing. Started last August, and I have no idea when it will change to something else. But it appears as though it's going to be a good while. I'm mostly traveling in an RV, which is currently sitting in Spokane, Washington. And right now, it appears as though I'm going to be in about 48 different churches this year. He sent me to do something very specific. He has sent me to do something very specific. Thank you, brother. I don't need any more of that. This is going to be so different. There's not going to be a dividing line. I'm ministering right now, in case you didn't know it. If you think this is introduction, it's not introduction. So don't miss it. Okay? He sent me to do something very specific. He sent me to give him the opportunity to manifest to people his love, to help people know that he loves them. Okay? And it doesn't matter who you are, where you're from, doesn't matter what your life has been so far. Everybody in this room is from a different starting point, aren't we? But we all have a need. It's true, we all need to breathe. That is so easily proven. You can say, well, I don't need to breathe. Well, go ahead. Show me how long you can go without breathing. If you can make it a minute, you'd be in the very small percentage of humans. A few have been through very difficult training, like Navy SEALs, and some of them can hold their breath up to 3 minutes. I'm not interested. If you've ever played athletics and had the breath knocked out of you, you don't like that feeling. You don't want that feeling. You want to breathe. Then the other thing we need is food, and you can go a while without food or water, but your need for something to drink or something to eat is going to compel you to do something, because you can't make it without it. But there is another need that we have that, while we don't acknowledge it consciously, every one of us has it. Every last one of us has it. And that is the need to be loved. We need to be loved and know we're loved. Now, the problem is with that is there's all kind of things we call love today. But there's only one love that can fill that emptiness right there. And it doesn't matter whether you're 10 years old sitting here, or if you're 30 years old or 75. And I venture to say I'm pretty close to being the oldest in the house. And if you're older, you probably don't want to admit it, so it's okay. But every one of us was created with an emptiness right here. You were created with an emptiness. You have it. You may not actually define it, but you feel it. There's an emptiness right here. And we do all kind of things trying to fill that emptiness. Some of them are not bad in and of themselves, but the problem is they're natural, they're not spiritual, they're not supernatural, they're not eternal. So consequently, they can't fill an eternal emptiness. You and I were created in our mother's wombs. Right. And so when you came out of the womb, you knew everything you were ever going to know. You had all the wisdom you were ever going to have. Right? No. So what was the only part of you created in the womb? The natural body. You were not created in the womb. Only the house you were going to live in was created in the womb. And this life is another womb. And if this is all you've got and all you want is this life, you got a problem, because I see young people sitting here and my memories of being your age is more vivid than my memories of yesterday. They say old folks can't minister to young people. We have a tremendous advantage. We've been there. They haven't been here. Right? I can relate to where you are. You can't. You have no way of relating to where I am. You can't imagine being this ancient, can you? Except I not only can imagine, I have vivid memories of being as young as you. I remember the night when I turned 18, my parents moved my bedroom to the basement. And that wasn't the dungeon, it was the basement. There was the door that went outside, whatever. I didn't feel like I was in the dungeon, but they felt like I needed more space since I was now 18. And I'll remember the night that I was in the basement. And in the middle of the night, I had a dream that Jesus came. It was very vivid, that Jesus came and I was left. And all by myself, I rolled out of the bed in the middle of the night. Got down on my knees by my bed with nobody praying with me, just me and Jesus. And that night, by myself, at 18 years old, I literally felt the Spirit of the Lord fill this emptiness. Completely filled it. And when it got completely full, I began to speak in other tongues. And I give testimony to you today. That emptiness has never been back one moment in all these years. And why would that be the case? If you can put on the screen for me, Romans chapter 5 and verse 5. Romans 5 and 5. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. So that night, what I was filled with was the Spirit of God. But since 1 John 4:16, 17, and 18 say that God is love, when I was filled with the Spirit of God, I was filled with the love of God. I was filled with the love of God. And since that day, it's never been an issue whether or not I'm loved, because I know I have the Spirit and that God is love. And if I have the Spirit of God, then I have the love of God abiding in me. Now, the problem is, there have been times I didn't always feel the love of God. Now, I wonder how many of us during this last 16 months has been afraid. Don't raise your hand, please. Because I don't want to embarrass you, because I know where I'm going. You've been afraid. Well, 1 John 4:18, please. 1 John 4:18 says, there is no fear in love. Perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. Well, Brother Wright, there's exceptions to that. Poor old God, he didn't know how to say it so that we understood there were exceptions there. Because this sounds like pretty absolute statements to me. So if I'm afraid of anything, it's not the thing I'm afraid of. What I need to find out is, why am I doubting God's love for me? Because the only way I can be afraid of anything is if I'm doubting God's love for me. Because his love, if you could leave that up there for a moment, I'd appreciate it. His love does what? Casts out fear. Now, somebody tell me the definition of darkness. The absence of light. In other words, you can't have darkness and light in the same place at the same time, because the definition of darkness is the absence of light. That means in the presence of light, there's no darkness. Here we go. Ready? The definition of fear is the absence of love. It's the absence of the confidence in the love of God. And if I'm afraid, it's because I don't trust God and his love for me. And isn't it amazing that God loves everybody in this room, no matter your age, no matter what your personal faith may be, whatever. He loves you. Now, the problem is we don't feel love. Why? Why don't we feel loved? Now, I'll tell you young people something. There'll be a point in time you'll think you're in love with somebody, but there's a problem. If they don't love you back, it's not really love. You can offer to people your willingness to love them. But if they don't receive that love, are you loved? No. So if God offers us his love, but we don't receive that love and reciprocate or turn it back, give it back, then are we loved? If I say to you, God loves you, and you go, I don't think so. Well, the problem is with us humans, who do we want to point a finger at? Not us. We want to point a finger at God. You say you love me, I don't feel loved. That's got to be your fault. No. If he's offering me his love, and I don't feel love, then there's something in me that is preventing me from feeling that love and believing that love and trusting that love. And so, what is the solution for that? Let the Lord show you whatever the obstacles are that's keeping you from believing his love, and let him help you to remove them. And he's no respecter of persons, and he will do that with everybody here. But there is a problem. Anybody know what the problem is? There's a problem. We don't let him, because it has to be our decision. Anybody ever wonder, why is there so much horrible stuff in the world? Why doesn't God do something about it? Okay, let's suppose God's going to do something about it. Well, the only way God can do something about it is to violate people's will and make them, against their will, do what's right. And so, since you're the one that wants God to not let bad stuff happen in the world, and he can only do that by violating people's will, then he gets to start with you. That means he gets to make you do what he wants you to do, no matter what you want. Any takers? Of course there's no takers, because we want God to violate everybody else's will and make stuff go right. Just leave us alone. Right? It's everybody else's fault. If he'd fix them, I'd be okay. No, it doesn't work like that. You see, it doesn't work like that. It doesn't work like that. So therefore, no matter how old you are, young or old or anywhere in the middle, God cannot make his love known to you against your will. You have to choose to let him do that. Well, how do I do that? Well, it's really simpler than you think. Now, the Lord sent me here today, and I'm going to make this statement because I know what he told me, and I have absolute confidence of what he said to me. Everybody in this room who wants to go home a different person, a better person, a loved person, is going to go home different. And if you go home the same person you walked in here, I'm not talking to a handful, I'm talking to every one of us. If you go home the same person you came in here, it's going to be by your choice, not his. Won't be his fault. It'll be your choice, because he's already done everything he can do before you finally make a choice. He's done everything he can do. Now, anything else he does has to be at your invitation. You have to make a decision. Now, the first thing standing in our way is things we've done we shouldn't have, and things we haven't done that we should have. And when God is more than willing to forgive every one of those things, then what's the problem? He can't forgive them unless I exercise my will to want to be forgiven. And the love of God is manifest in this room right now. You say, I'm not feeling anything. That very gentle, sweet presence that's not confrontational, it's inviting, it's so gentle and sweet. That's the love of God. And he's saying to you and I, this is what I want to do for you, but you have to choose. And so, the first step we're going to take, because I'm not here to preach a sermon. I'm here to minister to you. And I'm ministering the love of God to you. You want to know what I'm doing today? You want a title? There it is. I'm ministering the love of God to you. I'm not making it happen, but by the Holy Ghost, I'm leading you into places where you and Him can do business so that you can change by letting Him, by making the decision to let Him be involved. So, He promised that He would forgive us. He promised He would forgive us. But we have to ask Him. Well, I don't have anything to repent for. Then you just made yourself a liar. Because the Bible says if we say we have no sin, He is a liar. And we are a liar and the truth's not in us. If we say we have no sin, then we're a liar and the truth's not in us. Brother kindly warned me about this, so it's on me. Okay? All right. I'm just addicted to holding something when I minister. I don't know what to do with my hands when I'm wearing one of those wireless deals. I mean, those things you clip on or whatever. So it's okay. You can still hear me. It's okay. All right. All right. So don't worry about it. It's not their fault. It's mine. All right. Praise God. So right now, the Holy Ghost wants to give you a chance to let Him take your sin away. Anything you feel guilty about, anything you have regret over, anything you're disappointed in yourself over or situation over, anything that you'd undo if you could, anything. If you will confess them to Him, ask Him to forgive you, He will do it right here, right now. And you can go home with a clear conscience because that's the will of God. Okay? And we're just going to pray right where you are. You don't have to pray loud enough for the person next to you to hear you, but you have to speak it. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. So you have to speak it. The person sitting right next to you doesn't have to be able to hear what you're saying, but because it's confession and because I'm speaking and confessing my sin and asking the Lord to forgive me, I need to speak it in Jesus' name. You feel that right now? That's not emotion. Did you notice that? That's not emotion. I'm not trying to work your emotion up. The Spirit of the Lord is manifesting Himself right now. What you do with it is up to you. Come on. Come on. Some of you have repented of certain things in the past, but you took it home. You gave it to God in prayer, and then you took it back home with you. Isn't it time to finally leave stuff at His feet and walk away? He promised us we could be new. That's up to you. He has already offered. He is willing right now. But He cannot violate your will. You have got to make this choice yourself to confess and believe that He is forgiving you right now. Right now. He cut the high alaratatamanaya. Ye kiki e kulorotatamaya. Yay, kiki, yay, God. But what if I do this again? How about let's just take care of today and we'll take care of tomorrow. Come on. Wouldn't it be great to at least right now to finally know that all that guilt and shame is completely gone from your past? Wouldn't that be awesome to do that? You cannot do this with your mouth closed. Why? Because when my mouth is closed, I'm refusing to let my heart speak. Or maybe my heart doesn't have anything to say. That's why we have to speak. It doesn't have to be loud, but we have to speak it with our mouths because the Bible says we confess with our mouths what we believed in our hearts. And so therefore, when I'm speaking it, It's the abundance of my heart speaking, and that's the exercise of my will, which lets God work in me. If I don't speak it, I haven't exercised my will, and God's not going to violate your will. He's not going to do it. Come on. Come on. Come on. I don't know what you were expecting today. It might not have been this, but I'm telling you right now, why not? Why not let's go home different than we came in here? Why not let's go home different? Why not let's go home with this burden gone completely? In the name of Jesus, this burden of guilt, this regret, all this regret we have. Why don't we go home without that for a change? Can you imagine how light and free you will feel when all that burden of guilt and shame is gone? I can, because I've experienced it. It's amazing. It's amazing. The sun looks brighter. Yeah. Yeah. The mind is clear. Come on. Come on. But God can't forgive me what I've done. That's a lie. You won't find that in the Word of God. That's a lie. Wherever that thought's coming from, it's not coming from God or His love. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. The love of God prompts Him to give. But those He's loving must choose to receive. And how do I receive His love? By obeying His word and confessing my sins so that He can forgive me. Come on, we're not done yet. There's some folks here still on the border, and the Lord loves you so much, He's giving you the opportunity to step across the line from your will to His will. From your will to His will, He's giving you that opportunity. Come on, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, if you've repented and you believe He has forgiven you, would you just begin to thank Him for that? You have asked Him to forgive you. You believe He's heard you. Why don't you just begin to thank Him for that? Give Him thanks for that. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Father. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Now hear me right now. You might not be interested in this today, but you're not going to forget this. It's not going to leave your mind. You're never going to forget this again. This moment right now, you can't do anything to get it out of your mind or spirit. There's nothing you can do, because this isn't a man, you see. This is God. God's doing this. You will never, ever forget this day. You'll never forget this moment. And you know the good thing about that? Down the road, when you get desperate enough, you're going to hear these words: God loves me and He doesn't want me to feel this way. And wherever you are, you're going to say, you'd be desperate enough, you're going to stop right there and you're going to ask God to forgive you. And you're going to find out, I could have had this all that time. But that's okay. He's not forcing anybody, see? Now, some of you have made some real good progress. A few have not. And you go, okay, well, God doesn't love me. No, no, that's not the problem. Because the next obstacle that stands between us and the love of God is when we have people we won't forgive. Yeah. So, I mean, here's the thing. I just ask God to forgive me. And I'm going to say, Lord, I deserve for you to forgive me, but they don't deserve for me to forgive them. How does that work? Does that work okay? No. No. And there are some precious people in this room. Oh, you've tried, and that's your just, I've tried. I've had them tell people tell me that. I've tried to forgive. Well, let's see. If I've tried to forgive and I've forgiven, that must be God's fault. No. No. I realize I need to forgive. I pray to forgive, but I just can't let God be in control of the situation. I can't trust him with it because he might not do the bad stuff to them that I want him to do because they deserve it after what they've done to me. So I'm not going to forgive because I can't trust God to punish them. So I'm not forgiving so I can punish them. So if I was standing here today with a glass of poison and I said, okay, everybody that's got a grudge, come drink this poison and expect it to kill the person that you've got a grudge against. Would you do that? No, but that's what you do with bitterness. You think your grudge is going to punish them and the only person that's punishing is you. You. But you don't know what they've done to me. Jesus just forgave you. You have no idea what you've done to him. What I did wrong caused him to have to go to the cross and die the worst death that's ever been died, just so he could forgive me. That's what I did to him because of what I've done. Anybody done you that wrong? Let me see your hands. Where are your nail scars? Oh, so you've never been on a cross? So therefore, nobody's ever done you that wrong. I've told this story before. It's going to sound funny, but I'm just trying to make a point. Now, when I was a kid, we ate chicken necks. Anybody ever eaten a chicken neck fried, cooked for chicken neck? Okay. But let's say every time somebody hurts your feelings or whatever, and you have a grudge against them, you have to carry around a chicken neck. Well, you can carry one or two in your pocket or your purse or whatever, but when you keep accumulating them, because you will, next thing you know, you got to have a briefcase to carry them in. But with time, you keep accumulating them. Now you got to have a carry-on size suitcase. You got to drag. And you see, when you've got a grudge, you got to take it with you everywhere. Every moment of the day, you live with that grudge. Consciously, subconsciously, you live with that grudge. Well, over time, you keep accumulating chicken necks. Next thing you know, you got a full-size suitcase. But that's exactly. The problem is the ones you've had the longest, they've started to rot. Now they stink. So you not only are hauling around this suitcase full of chicken necks, now everywhere you go, there's a smell that precedes you called a bad attitude. And after a while, you got two or three, four suitcases you're having to carry around because you're not going to let go of any chicken neck. You're just going to hang on to every grudge. So maybe you needed a job and you go into for the interview. You come in through the door hauling all your suitcases and the smell is just ridiculous. And the receptionist says, well, who are you? Well, I'm here for a job interview. What's all that? They're my chicken necks. Well, what are you doing? Why? They go with me everywhere. So if we hire you, every day you come to work, you're taking off, bringing all these chicken eggs, oh, there'll be more with time. And that smell, you're going to have that smell with you every day? Yeah, because I have to keep them with me because I choose to never let any of them go. And we're chuckling at that, and that's what was the intention. But the reality is much worse than carrying around suitcases full of chicken eggs. Because the problem is the person with the grudge is the last person to know. Everybody else recognizes you've got the grudge because of your stinky attitude. And everybody's against me. And everybody owes me something because I'm a victim. Because you're not free. You cannot hold on to a grudge without becoming the prisoner of that grudge. You're bound by it. And there are wonderful people in this room right now who have tried to deal with hurts from your past, things that's happened to you. You try to deal with them. But you haven't just let them go. Now's the time. You want to know the love of God. You want to be able to experience and feel the love of God every day. You've repented of your sins, but now you got to forgive those grudges. Because Jesus said, I can't forgive you if you don't forgive those that have wronged you. It's time. I loose the spirit of the love of God in this place. In Jesus' name. I loose the spirit of the grace of God in this place. You've got to speak it again, okay? You've got to speak it. It doesn't have to be loud, but you, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth has to speak. Come on, I've got to speak it. Father, by your help and grace, I forgive so-and-so for whatever they did. I've got to do that. Come on, come on. In the name of Jesus, this is your time. This is your place. This is your opportunity to go home with a new life. But I've been saved. Yeah, I know. A lot of us have been saved a long time, but we're still carrying around all this baggage, and it's cheating us. We're cheating ourselves from the victory that God has promised us. We're cheating ourselves because we won't let go. The Lord is here to help you let go today because he loves you. The Lord is here to help you be free. You're the prisoner of the grudge, not the person you've got a problem with. You're the prisoner. Come on. Come on, in Jesus' name. This is what we're doing today. This is not preaching. This is ministry. But all I can do is be used of the Holy Ghost to lead you to a place where you and the Lord can do business, where you and the Lord can have this opportunity together, where you and him can deal with these things, where you give him the opportunity to make you new, to set you free. Come on. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He ka ha sa ta ta ba ha ya. He ki ki he lu ro to lu ro to bo ko ra ya. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. He lu lu ro to lu ro to bo ko ra ya. He la la ra ya. He la ra ta ha he le re ti. He la ra ti ti he ka ha ya. He la bo bo ko si. Ye la la da 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 ba. Ye kolororobokoradabai. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. You can't have hope for the future and joy over the future while you're grieving over your past and what people have done to you and what they didn't do that they should have done. Come on. In Jesus' name. It's time to be free. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, be free. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, be free. He da la da 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 ha ya. Ye lo lo ro to bo ko ra da ha ya. Come on. Come on. It's not even 11 o'clock yet. We have no reason to be in a hurry. We have no time pressure. We've got the time to let you and Jesus do business. We've got the time for you and Jesus to settle some things once and for all, so you can go home new, so you can go home free. Oh, free. Being free is one of the most awesome things there is. Free, free, free in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Let it go. Let it go. Your life isn't better because you're punishing somebody for the wrong they've done. Your life isn't better. Your life isn't better. Your life isn't better because you're holding a grudge. Your life isn't better because you've got bitterness or resentment or even hatred. That doesn't make your life better. That makes you in bondage. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, it means you're in bondage. You might as well be in chains on your hands and your ankles. You're in bondage if you have grudges. You're not free to be you. You're not free to be you. God wants you to be free so you and Him can be together who you're supposed to be. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He ta ta ha ya la ta ta ta. Ye lo lo ro to lo ro to bo ko sa ta ha ya. Ye ki ki he ka la ra ta ta ha ya. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on. Come on. We're not in a hurry. This isn't just your eternity here. This is the quality of your life today, tomorrow, next week, next month. This is your opportunity to look at the future instead of feeling depression or discouragement or despair because you don't see any hope. This is your way to get rid of all the baggage that's keeping you from having hope for the future. And therefore joy over your future rather than dread. So many of us, we face tomorrow with dread and no hope, and we don't know why. Because we're hauling our grudges from one day to the next, and they steal our hope, and they prevent us from having any joy. You can't have joy and grief at the same time. And while you're grieving over all this stuff that's been done to you or that wasn't done to you that should have been done, while you're grieving, you can't have hope for the future, and you can't have joy in your future. Come on. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He ta lo ro to lo ro to bo ko ra ta 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 ha ya. Ye ki ki he ka la ra ta ta ha ya. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on. Come on. In Jesus' name. He loves you. But you need to let Him love you. Come on. He loves you. And this is how He wants to love you. He wants to love you by setting you free. He wants to love you by setting you free. Come on. Receive it in Jesus' name. He ta ta ha la ra ta 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 ha ya. Ye ki ki he ka la ra ta ta ha ya. Ye ki ki he ka la ra ta ta ha ya. He la la ra ta ha ya. Ye ki ki he ka la ra ta ta ha ya. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He bakasata tahaya. Ye koloro tororoto bokoraya. Ye kiki he katahaya. Oh, hallelujah. 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 If you've asked Him to help you forgive, and if you've spoken the words, Father, by your grace, I forgive them. I forgive them. Then you need to begin to lift your hands and thank Him for helping you to forgive. Thank Him for setting you free of this bondage. Thank you for setting you free of this burden. Thank you. Thank you. Receive it. Father, I receive deliverance. I receive freedom and liberty from these grudges I've carried. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Ilamo mokore te tihe katahaya. Ye kikihe kalarata tatahaya. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Do you know why it's so important to forgive? So that you can, so you can feel what it feels like to be free. Because people are going to do you wrong. People are going to do you wrong in the future. And so rather than going back to what you used to do, just hanging on to that hurt, hanging on to that grudge, you're going to say, no, no, no. I'm not going back to being in bondage. It doesn't matter what they've done to me. I'm going to stay free. I give this to you, God. I'm not going to let this get in my heart. I'm not going to carry this round. I'm not going to become bitter. I'm giving it to you. I don't want it. I don't want it. Amen. I don't want it. I want to be free. Not only that, let me tell you what happens, okay? Here's what happens. Somebody's got a problem, okay? Their problem causes them to act in ways that's not right, and so they treat you wrong. What they're doing there is they're trying to take their problem and make it your problem, your choice. Because every time you hold a grudge, you've allowed that person to take their problem and make it your problem. And so now you have your problems and their problems. And the only way to be free is to not give their problems back to them, because it's what we want to do. Just give them all to God and say, here it is, Lord. I give it all to you. I give all these problems to you. I don't want them. I'm not carrying them. Now, we've asked God to forgive us of our sins. We've asked God to help us to forgive others. One final thing, if I want to be able to feel the love of God, experience the love of God anytime, any place. Some of you have heard the story, but I was molested when I was 5 years old. Sexually molested by an older boy. I was just five. I don't remember exactly. He was 10, 11, 12, something like that. His backyard matched up with our backyard, and there was a fence between them, but I was the oldest, and I had a brother only 2 and a half, so I didn't have anybody to play with most of the time, so my mother would allow that boy to come over in our yard and play. And, of course, there's one thing about boys. They have a tendency to hero worship older males, which means they lose their ability to say no, because they're afraid of losing that involvement of that male. So they do all kind of things wrong, trying to keep from getting rejected. And so, I don't know how long he'd been coming into the yard and playing, but it was a pretty good while, several months. And one day he said, let's play a game. I'm five. We've been playing. And he was being very patient with me, and it was awesome. I'm only five. I got this older boy that's taking the time to play. I mean, that's very heady experience for a child. So when he said, let's play a game, well, absolutely we're playing this game. I mean, you're the older male, you're the boss, right? Whatever you want to do, we're going to do that. Except this time he said, we need to go hide to do it. And I went, okay. I don't know what kind of game this is, but we'll go hide. And so the first time that day, he took me under the house and did some things. And then he did something else behind the shed. And my mother there was a window looked out over the backyard, and she looked out there, couldn't see us. So she came looking for us. And she caught him doing these things to me. And she freaked out. And she began to yell and scream at that boy, get over back into your yard. Don't you ever come in this yard again. I don't know what's going on. I don't understand what just happened. I wasn't comfortable with the game, but I was afraid to lose this playmate, this older boy that was taking time with me. So I went along. I wasn't comfortable with it. But then all of a sudden, my mother shows up and just goes off. And I don't have a clue why she's reacting so. And she screams and tells that boy, get over that fence. Don't you ever come back. And all I could hear was, I'm never going to have a playmate again. Well, then once he got over the fence, she turned on me. And instead of calming down, and I don't blame her, she was very fearful. That's what that was. It was not anger. It was fear. Because she didn't know what kind of damage had been done to me. So she begins at the top of her lungs to try to explain to me that what was happening, what I was participating in, was bad. Well, I didn't hear her say that that was bad. I heard her say that I was bad. I was just playing a game. From my 5-year-old perspective. From that day, for the next 33 years, that is no exaggeration. On my good days, I didn't like myself. On my bad days, I hated myself. Now, when something like that happens to you, you're going to go one of two directions. Some that have stuff like that happen says, well, if you think that was bad, you watch, I'm going to show you bad. If you're going to reject me because I felt damaged, I felt broken, I felt unfixable. I didn't understand what I was feeling. I felt those things. I felt those things for 33 years and didn't understand why I was feeling them and why I felt that way and why I didn't. Because the other way that people go is they say, you know, I'm not bad and I'm going to try to be as good as I can. And so I spent the next 33 years trying to be as good as I could, but it was never enough. I never was good enough in my own mind to feel like that fixed it. No matter how much good I did, no matter how much people bragged on me for being good, it never fixed what was broken inside of me. It never fixed it. Never fixed it. So the only way I could just survive from day to day is I had to push it out of my conscious mind down into my subconscious so I didn't think about it, because I didn't want to think about it. From the moment my mother stopped talking in the yard and she took me by the hand, took me in the house, from that day for the next 33 years, I never spoke to a living, breathing human being about what happened to me. I lived in terror. If people found out what happened to me, they would reject me. I got the Holy Ghost 7 years later. I go to the Naval Academy. I get married afterwards. I become a preacher. And on my good days, I didn't like myself. On my bad days, I hated myself. I'm trying so hard to earn God's love, to earn everybody else's love, to earn self-respect, because I had none. I didn't respect me. I didn't like me. I was broken inside. Now, I didn't realize it, but I was putting on a good front. Most people would have never, ever believed I felt that way. I'm not telling them. Last thing I want to do is tell them. That's the last thing. I feel broken enough. I don't want to confirm it to people. So I hid it. And I acted completely different than the way I was feeling, hoping they wouldn't figure it out. But I'm 38. And I can't live like this anymore. I've done all I could do. I've gone as far as I can go. I don't know what's wrong with me, but I'm broken. And the only one that can fix me is God, because I've done everything I know to do. I've tried everything I know to try. And God sent me to a man of God that he had spoken to for me. And the Lord spoke to that man of God what was wrong. And that man of God ministered to me and he prayed for me. And here's what he helped me to do. He helped me to understand that if I can have a grudge against others, and according to Acts 24:16, if I can have a grudge against God, then I can have a grudge against myself. And that's really what I had. I hated myself. I blame myself for what happened to me. Now, that doesn't make sense, does it? But that's the way emotions work. We're not talking about the head. We're talking about the heart, the emotions. And I beat myself up, and I blame myself for that. And he said, the only way you can be free is to let God help you to forgive yourself. So your wounds, bitterness is the infection in our emotional wounds. And those wounds would heal if we could just get the infection out. And once the infection's out, the wound will begin to heal and the pain will go away. And there are people sitting in this room right now. Maybe you weren't molested. But you have so much stuff you blame yourself for. How do I know? Let me prove it. When you do something wrong, or I would call stupid, you talk to yourself and say stuff to yourself about yourself that you wouldn't let anybody else say to you. Yeah, it is right. Anytime I made a mistake, it was, you stupid idiot. What? You're hopeless. What's wrong with you? You'll never get it right. You'll never do anything right. There is no hope for you. I got a question. Does that help you? No, it doesn't help you. But you know what it proves? You got a grudge against yourself and you need to be free. And you hear me. You see this, just this number of people? I went 33 years not being able to tell anybody what happened to me. But God so set me free and God so healed me. I've told this story to thousands of people. Some of them one at a time. Some of them in small groups. Right now on my YouTube channel, I've got two full seminars where I talk about this whole thing. Do I act embarrassed? Nah. You know why? I'm healed. You see that scar?
Yep.
Can you verify to everybody there's a scar?
Yep.
Okay, watch this. If that was a wound, you couldn't do that. It would hurt too much. But you know what this proves? The wound is healed. Anybody got a button? You know what a button is? That's when somebody does or says something that sets you off. And you don't even know why it sets you off. That hurt inside, that's a wound, and that's your button. And all somebody has to do is touch that wound, and you don't even know why you're acting like that. I live that. I live that. Riding down the road, they talk about road rage. It's not road rage. That's people. People have a button. And so somebody's not paying attention, they cut in front of you, and you feel so affronted. You feel so wronged. And you get all crazy. So you've never accidentally cut in front of somebody? Oh, that's different. They ought to know I didn't intend to do that. So if it's me accidentally cutting in front of somebody, you know, hey, cool it, man. I didn't mean anything. I'm just okay. No, no. But somebody accidentally cut in front of me, button. Sometimes it's just a grenade going off. Sometimes it's it's TNT going off. Sometimes it's an atom bomb. And everything close by gets wiped out. Why? Why? Because that hurt inside, it's not dealt with. You want to go home different and be different forever? You've got to finally let God help you to forgive yourself for all that stuff you beat yourself up over. Now, I'm going to beat myself up. I'm not going to let you beat on me. No, 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 no. It's my privilege to beat myself senseless over stuff. But it's not yours. Well, what does that mean? That means I got all my feelings on my elbows, and all I have to do is bump into somebody, and I'm ready to fight. I'm ready to get in their face. You, how dare you? That's a miserable way to live. It's a frightening way to live, because have you ever scared yourself? Have you ever lost it so bad you scared yourself? Hello? Yeah, don't avoid it now, guys. No, because the Lord loves you too much. He loves you, but you have to let Him love you. Now, it's one thing to ask God to forgive you of your sins. It's another thing for you to forgive those that wronged you. But the most important person to forgive is yourself. So that you quit beating yourself up, blaming yourself. You know, anybody ever play these games? Woulda, coulda, shoulda? Yeah. Yeah. You know why you play that game? Because you got a grudge against yourself. How about this game? Anybody ever play the what if game? Yeah, exactly. But who do we in here, who do we blame for that stuff? Me. If I would have just, I should have, I could have, I didn't. So this all happened. And now I don't know what to do about it. And now I'm hurting so bad inside. But the last thing I want to admit to anybody is that I'm hurting. So when somebody is touching my hurt, I don't react as if I'm hurting. I blow up. Because I've got to put up a smoke screen to protect myself that says, I'm bigger and badder than you. Don't you mess with me. It's too late. You've already been messed with. That's why you're so angry. It's too late. You've already been messed with. That's why you're hurt. That's why you're wounded. That's why you have no hope. That's why you have no joy. That's why you have no peace. That's why you don't like yourself. According to the Word of God, the love of God will help you to love yourself. Now, love and like are two different things. I love myself because God loves me. And when I received His love for me, that showed me how much value I had to Him. Right? That's how much I'm worth to Him. He died for me. He died for you individually. He died for me as an individual. That's how much He loved me. He gave Himself in my place for me. He gave Himself in your place for you because He loves you that much. He loves you that much. But I've got to receive that love. But again, I can't receive that love and He can't work in my life until I exercise my will to let Him. And that's what's going to happen here right now. Those who want to, again, you've got to speak this out loud, but it doesn't have to be loud enough for anybody to hear. Father, by your help and grace, I forgive and release myself for being molested. Whatever else you need to. Every memory you have that you're afraid to think of because you don't know what to do with it, because it hurts too much. It's a wound that needs to be healed, and before it can be healed, it needs to be cleansed of the bitterness you have. And you can only be cleansed of the bitterness by asking God. You've already asked God to help to forgive you, for Him to forgive you. You've already asked God to help you to forgive others. Now it's the will of God for you to ask God to help you to forgive yourself. Only by His love, by His blood, by His grace can I forgive myself. I don't have any ability to forgive myself, but He will enable me to forgive myself so I can be, my wounds can be cleaned, and so God can cause the wounds to heal, take the pain away from my life, and give me hope and joy of the future. Come on. You got to pray it, your own words. Nobody around you needs to be able to hear it. This is very personal between you and God. But you need to be able to do this. Come on. Whatever you're carrying from your past, if you can remember it and it embarrasses you, if you can remember it and you feel regret and shame over it, if you can remember it and you wish it hadn't happened, or what didn't happen, you wish it had happened, but and it makes you feel negative about yourself, He wants to set you free from this so you can be the person you're supposed to be, that He wants you to be. You're going to like that person. You don't like this one. You'll like the person He'll make you to be. You don't like this one now. Oh, yeah, I do. No, yeah, right. Yeah. The next time something happens and you begin to go off on yourself, then try to tell yourself that you like yourself. You don't. But it's all this stuff that has to be cleared out so you can be free. And I can say to you today, I love Chester Wright. Why? Because Jesus loves Chester Wright. And His love for me gives me the right to love myself. His love for me. I don't have to let my past destroy my future because I've got all these feelings that drive me to do things that deep down inside I don't really want to do. And that's what happens to us. That stuff we carry around inside, it drives us to do stuff we don't really want to do because we're so angry, we're so frustrated, we're so confused, we're so bitter. We don't know what's wrong. We know something's wrong, but we don't know what's wrong. And we're afraid to tell the people we hang out with that, hey, something's wrong, because you can't afford to be vulnerable. You call them friends. But anybody you got to pretend with is not your friend. Anybody you can't be real with is not your friend. Anybody you can't tell that you're hurting, they're not your friend. What they really are is someone that you're pretending with because they're pretending with you. And you're not being honest with them because they're not being honest with you. And you call them friends and you hang out with them because that's what hurting people do. And that's why people get in groups or gangs or whatever it is, because I can't protect myself from all this stuff. So I've got to get together with other people that's hurt like me so we can all hurt somebody else before they hurt us, because I need somebody to watch my back because I live in fear because I don't believe I'm loved. I live in fear because I don't believe I'm loved. But then the very people that I'm trusting to protect me keep me in prison because I can't be real with myself. I can't be honest with myself because my friends, they're going to reject me if I do. So I live in this prison. I didn't build the walls. I just choose to stay there. Whatever was done to me that shouldn't have been done, whatever wasn't done that should have been done, somebody else build the walls, but I'm living in the prison by choice. Somebody else build the walls, but I'm living there. I'm choosing to live there. And we tell ourselves it's safe there. It's not safe at all. It's torment. It's torment. Now, you've prayed and asked God to forgive you of your sins. You've prayed and asked God to give you the grace to forgive those that wronged you. And now those that want to be free, truly free, it's your opportunity to pray and ask God to forgive you. And I'm suggesting, you don't have to pray these exact words, but Father, by your help and grace, I forgive and release myself for and fill in the blank. And when you do that, another memory is going to come. And for that memory, you go, Father, by your help and grace, I forgive and release myself for. Now, here's what's going to happen. You're going to make really good progress today. But if you've had this hurt very long, you got a bunch of stuff. So what the Lord is doing for you today is giving you a direction of how to be free. And over the rest of the day, and then over the next couple of days, the next week or so, memories you've been putting out of your mind because you didn't know what to do with them because they hurt too much and they were too frustrated, they're going to start coming up. And instead of doing what you always do, push them back down. No, if you, with that memory, if you'll just go, Father, by your help and grace, I forgive and release myself for whatever that is, it'll go away and you're one step closer to being completely free, completely whole, pain-free, and now with joy and hope. Come on, we're going to pray right now. We're going to start right now. The Lord is willing to give you enough of a good head start on this right now so that you will have the encouragement to follow through on your own. Come on. In Jesus' name, Father, by your help and grace, I forgive and release myself for. Because it's the will of God for your wounds to be clean, so your hurts can be healed, so your pain can go out of your life, so you can be free. It's the will of God for you to be free. It's the will of God for you to be whole. It's the will of God for you to have peace. It's the will of God for you to have hope. It's the will of God for you to have joy. It's the will of God for you to anticipate and look forward to your future and not dread your future. What's next? What's the next bad thing going to happen to me? No, no, no. Come on. Don't let anybody around you affect you and keep you from praying this. If they don't want to pray, that's fine. That's their business. But just kindly say, please, please respect me for a moment and let me pray myself if they're trying to bother you. Just say that to them. Please, would you at least respect me for this moment? You don't want to pray, that's fine. Nobody's making you pray. But would you please respect me for this moment and leave me alone for a moment and let me pray? I need this. Come on, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on. It's still only 11:30. Surely you at least have church here till noon. So there's no reason to be in a hurry. God is doing this for you. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God's trying to help you now. This is the answer you've been looking for. This is the answer. Lord, what's wrong with me? Well, how do I go forward from here, God? I want to be free, Lord. I want to feel you. I want to know you love me. What's wrong with me, Father? The Lord's given you that answer and what to do about it. But he can't make you cooperate. That's between you and him. He can't violate your will. You've got to exercise your will. Come on. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Come on. In the name of Jesus, the Lord loves you, but you've got to let him. The Lord loves you, but you've got to let him. Come on. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord loves you, but you've got to choose to let him. You've got to choose to receive his love and let his love and his grace enable you to do this. Come on. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He tie kusi kiki hekatahaya. Ye kiki hekatahaya. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. He lamu karate tiki hekatahaya. Ye la ratatabaya. The Lord loves you. Please, for your sake, let him love you. Please, don't leave this service feeling unloved like you did when you came in here. In Jesus' name, he loves you. He died on the cross for you so that you could be free. Come on. Come on, in the name of Jesus. He died on the cross for you so you could be free, so you could be whole. In Jesus' name, so you could have a future. Some of us are so stuck in our pasts, we don't have a future. We don't believe we have a future. Come on, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. He ki ki he kalarata tahaya. Ye ki ki he kularata tahaya. Halarata tahaya le de tie katatahaya. Ye ki ki he kolorota lorota bosaya. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. He la bobo kore de tie katahaya. Ye ki ki he kalarata tahaya. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One more time, it's time for us to begin to thank him for what he's done. And what he's going to continue to do. Come on. Let's thank him for what he's done. And what he's going to continue to do. Some of you are going to want to go someplace and get alone. Some of you are going to want to go home, go someplace and get alone. So you can talk to God without worrying about what somebody next to you is thinking or feeling. That's fine. You're going to want to go someplace and get alone. In Jesus' name. Yeah. I'll say it again. Some of you are going to want to spend some time alone this afternoon with just you and Jesus so you can talk to him without worried about somebody worrying about somebody being nearby and them listening and whatever. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, it is the will of God for you to be free. It's the will of God for you to be whole. Come on, let's thank him. Come on, let's thank him. Let's thank him. Let's give him the glory and the honor and the praise and thanksgiving. Thank you, Jesus. 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 In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, 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 Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. Praise God. The Lord bless you. Please continue to pray for your pastor and his wife. Please do that. I have a service in Pawtucket at 1:30. I'm going to need to leave. Please don't be offended and consider me rude that I don't have time to stand and shake everybody's hand. In Jesus' name. The Lord's not done here yet. Brother Ford is more than able to take you the last bit of this journey. And I trust him and I trust Jesus. So if you would forgive me, I need to be on the road to be able to make sure that we can get there on time. Okay? The Lord bless you. And it's good to be with you again. And I hope to see you again in the relatively near future. Praise God. Bless you.
Thanks for you. Hallelujah. 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 As Brother Wright was talking, it was something was coming to me that I did 43, 44 years ago. Something stupid, something little. And I just took it and I laid it back at the feet of the Lord and said, God, you know, I don't think I've ever asked your forgiveness for that before. This is can be a very hard thing to do. And it's uncomfortable. And there's going to be times where you're not going to feel like you're in the right position to hand it over to God at the moment. Don't believe that. If God has brought something to your mind, it's the right time to hand it over to God, and it's going to free you. It's going to take weights off of you. I remember when I received the Holy Ghost. This is, you know, when you receive the Holy Ghost, the burdens, the things that are lifted off of you. It's like, wow. And I went out, and it was late at night. It was closing in on midnight, actually. And we were over the Hart's house at that point. And God filled me with the Holy Ghost. And you know, the next day, I looked at flowers. Now, anybody that knows me, I looked at flowers and I said, I've never seen that before. Look at the colors. Look at how many different varieties they are. And I picked up on smells that I never smelled before. And you know, it's because I was a little more free to express myself the way that God made me. And God has things that will, that as you peel, we talk about peeling the onion, the little things off, as God brings something to your mind and you take it and you set it off to the side and you come closer and closer to the core person, you become more and more free. And I'm an electrician, everybody knows this, and I was in an electrical supply house and there was something on the wall and I forgot what it was, and one of the people that I knew there, her name was Noemi. And I looked at a tool, and it was like, to me, it was like a miniature kid's tool. So I said, hey, that thing is pretty cute. She said, that's not very masculine. And you know what? It didn't faze me one iota. You know why? Because I was free from that. It didn't bother me. But I can tell you a lot of people, if some woman said, that's not masculine, whoa, what are you talking about? God wants us to be free. Free to enjoy. Free to love. Free to express. And as these things pop up in your mind, and I am convinced that it's going to happen, as they pop up in your mind, give them over to God and let Him make you a little bit more free, a little bit more you, a little bit more relaxed. I don't know, probably some people here going through the COVID thing made them nervous. Through that whole process, I was chuckling because I had peace inside. I was free to express the things that God had placed within me. I had no problems with it. We don't need to be somebody that we're not. That's one of the most vulnerable things you can ever do, is actually express yourself. We say, I'm a glass house. And I've been there, and I understand it. But I'm also telling you that the freer you are to express anything in your life, good or bad, that's when you become healed. That's when you help others through barriers that they could never get through any other way. If you're bold enough to be open and honest, why can't I do that? And the people you're talking to, why can't they do that? And then we don't have all the bitterness and all the anger and all the fighting and all the bickering. And that's not God's ways. Peace, love, joy. Amen? Amen. We're just going to pray right now for 1 minute here, and then we're going to do the announcements. God, Your word and Your spirit and Your love are so amazing. I thoroughly enjoy being in Your presence, Lord. And I am so thankful, Lord, that You have allowed me to learn the things, because Your word is truth and truth is going to make us free. I'm so thankful that we have learned things, Lord, that free us to be free. Not what people expect us to be, but what You made us to be, Lord. We don't have to go around with the crowd. We don't have to do the things that people do just because of influences, Lord. We're free. We're free. Free indeed. Free by the things that You have done for us. Free, Lord God, by Your grace and Your mercy and Your love, then we are able to express those to others also, Lord, and they can become free, and Your kingdom will expand, Lord. Continue to help us to grow. Continue to draw us closer to You. Continue, Lord God, to bring us to a place, Lord God, where we are so free, Lord, that people will see You in us. We're not bound up by things, Lord. Thank You, Lord, as we do, Lord. Go different places, meet different people, Lord God. Let Your spirit flow. Let Your love flow. Let Your grace flow. Let them say, He was with Jesus, or she was with Jesus. Thank You so much, Lord. Thank You, Lord. Hallelujah. In Your name, Jesus. In Your name, Jesus.